Okay, so should I say welcome to the last class in this course, and we have just looked at the language of epistemic logic, a simple language in which we looked at the syntax, we looked at the notion of possible world semantics and truth assignment. So now let's see what happens when things happen in this world essentially. So what is the effect of actions and how do we deal with them essentially? Now agents can do two kinds of actions. One is that they can change some propositions in this thing. Now for example, if you have a robot going around picking up blocks and putting them elsewhere, then at some point it will remove a block from a table so that it will no longer be true, and it will add a new proposition saying that it is holding the block. The kind of thing that the planning community looks at essentially. So those are the kind of changes that happen. The other kind of change that happens is, or actions that can happen, is that when they reveal information essentially, either privately to another agent or publicly by broadcasting it essentially, or making public announcement essentially. So an agent may announce that a particular proposition is true or false essentially. So we will see, for example, that Annie will announce that she is holding zero or something like that, and then what is the effect of that on other people's knowledge essentially. The agents receiving the information can then eliminate possible world essentially. So that is the whole name of the game, as to, you know, try to arrive at the real possible world, try to arrive at what is true essentially. The trouble is that this kind of reasoning involves models, working with action models which work, we deal with in dynamic epistemic logic, and which is, we do not really have time to go to into. So that is why one of the reasons I have given you the references at the beginning of this set of two lectures, where you can look at some publicly available talks on dynamic epistemic logic. What we will do is just an informal treatment of that essentially, and we will do this with this very famous well known puzzle. It is called the Muddy Children puzzle, and some of these slides, as you can see, have been prepared by Vishwajit Venugopal, who is a fourth year student just writing his report, I hope. So the problem is like this, that there are some n children playing together, and they have been warned by their parents not to get dirty and stuff like that, which parents often do. And during play, some k children, it could be 0 also or it could be n also, do get their foreheads dirty essentially. Now a child can see if somebody else's forehead is dirty, but she cannot see whether her own forehead is dirty. It is like this cap problem that we talked about earlier, in some sense that you cannot see what is the color of your cap, you cannot see whether your forehead is dirty or not essentially. But also they are so scared of their parents that they do not tell anything to anyone. Even if they see that somebody's forehead is dirty, they do not tell anyone to anyone. So the game is going on, some people are possibly dirty, and then along comes the father of one of the kids, and he makes an announcement. It is a public announcement so that everybody can hear it. He says that at least one of you has mud on your forehead, or he could have said simply that there is a child whose forehead is muddy or something like that, as long as you interpret it correctly as an existential statement. Which means that there at least one of you has mud on your forehead. What happens then essentially? After that, he repeatedly asks every child, well, not every child, he asks a public question that do you know whether your forehead is muddy or not essentially. And the assumption here is that, like Garozzo and Belladonna, all the children are perceptive, intelligent, truthful, and answer at the same time essentially. The moment the man asks the question, if the child knows the answer and the child is perfectly rational, you can say, will answer the question truthfully essentially. So what will the children say is the question. So let us say that it so happens that k of those children have got muddy foreheads essentially, and then it will turn out that for the first k minus 1 times when the father asks this question, all the children will reply no essentially, but the kth time he asks the question, all the children with muddy foreheads will simultaneously answer yes essentially. So this is very similar to the to the situation where we had those two numbers and you had to find out which of them has a larger number. But after a series of answers, you know more. So, you know some more information. So, you kind of prune the set of possible worlds that you are looking at, and eventually when you are certain enough, you can answer yes essentially. So, that is what is happening here. So, let us analyze this problem. What if there was only one muddy forehead, that is if k was 1. The number of children is n essentially. Since the father truthfully announced that at least one child has muddy forehead, we can now know that k is greater than 0. So, at least somebody has got out this thing. If k is 1, if it happens that k were to be 1, then only that child would not have known that his head was or her head was muddy, and he would in fact not have known that there is any muddy forehead, because all the other children would have clean foreheads. So, this child will come to know that it is his or her forehead which is muddy, and so at the very first instance, he being a very bright child will answer yes, I know that my forehead is muddy. So, if k is equal to 1, the case is simple essentially. Now, let us say if there are two muddy foreheads essentially, and let us say these children are A and B. So, Annie and Bob, let us say. When the father asks the question for the first time, they both see mud on the other child's forehead. So, they have no reason to think that they have got mud on their head, but they have a reason to expect the other child to say yes, because they think, both A and B think that the other child will figure out that the other child has got a muddy forehead essentially. So, if A reasons as follows, that if A's forehead was not muddy, B would see only clean foreheads. So, A is imagining that k is equal to 1 essentially, and he says that because k is 1 and he knows that B's head is muddy, B will come out and say yes essentially. But because B does not come out and say yes when the question is asked, the answer dawns upon A and B at the same time, that both of them have their foreheads muddy. So, both of them after the second time the father asks the questions will answer yes essentially. And you can see that we can extend this argument for any k. If k is equal to 3, then each of those 3 people who have muddy foreheads can see 2 children. So, they would imagine the scenario where after the second round both those 2 children would say yes, and if when they say no after the second round, in the third round they are compelled to say that their forehead is muddy, and likewise for 4 and so on essentially. So, this is a kind of reasoning which is happening, and dynamic epistemic logic essentially gives you a mechanism for arriving at these answers. We will just get a glimpse of what is happening there, but we will not do any formal stuff here. Now, if you look at this case, if you forget about the case where k was 1 and look at all the cases where more than one child was had a muddy forehead. In some sense, the father's announcement is nothing new to any of the children essentially, because every child knows at least one other child whose head forehead is muddy. So, that fact is known to everyone essentially already. When k is equal to 1, then there is one child who does not know this fact essentially, but when k is more than 1, every child knows that somebody's forehead is muddy. So, father has said something new essentially. So, the question that one might ask is that does the father's statement contribute to them arriving at the answer? The question, does it contribute the statement that at least one of its forehead is muddy useful? The answer it turns out is that yes, the announcement and the subsequent questions and the negative responses by the other children were instrumental in each child being able to arrive with a correct answer at an appropriate time essentially. So, here is another example of a public announcement. So, we have seen this situation where Annie has picked up card 0, Bob has got card 1, and Kathy has got card 2, and we had seen this Kripke structure with those 6 states, where the one with the square box is the real state showing 0, 1 and 2 respectively for Annie, Bob and Kathy, and the indistinguishability relation between for the 3 players. Now, the moment Annie announces that she does not hold 1, which means the two states which begin with 1, 102 and 120, everybody knows that those two states are not possible. So, they are forced to remove those two states from their possible world model of from the Kripke structure, and whatever remains are those four states and those four edges between those four states essentially, for A and B essentially and C. Now, you can see that after Annie says that she does not have card 1, Kathy knows that Bob has card 1 essentially. So, look at Kathy. So, we are looking at this state, okay, and we are asking the question in this state. Though there is no state from this that Kathy can reach, okay. So, we have not drawn the self loops here for all these diagrams, self loops are always there, but there is no other state in with. So, whatever Kathy knows about that state, so the moment Annie knows that she does not have 1, Kathy who is holding 2, so Kathy knows that she is holding 2 and she now knows that Annie is not holding 1, so she knows that Annie is holding 0 and therefore, Bob is holding 1. So, that is the informal argument. The formal argument is that the only state reachable for Kathy from this state is this state itself, and therefore, if whatever is true in this state, Kathy now knows essentially. Also, that by a similar argument, she also knows that what is Annie's card. So, she knows that she herself is holding 2, Annie has said that she is not holding 1, so she is holding 0, and by the similar argument, she figures out that this thing. But now, notice that Bob still does not know what is Annie holding essentially, and the reason for that, as you can see, is that because Bob still has two states to worry about, and the other state is this one, because that is connected to this thing from Bob. And Bob actually, if you look at it carefully, Bob does not really get any information, because actually Bob is himself holding 1 here. So, Bob knows that Annie is not holding 1, and in this related state also Bob is holding 1. So, Annie's statement has not added anything to Bob's knowledge. Bob does not know who is holding 0 and who is holding 2. So, Bob is still not able to answer, but because Kathy was holding 2, she could come to this answer essentially.
Doesn't this also mean that there
is no indistinguishable state? Well, in the given state 0, 1, 2, there is only one reachable state. But if the state was something else, then it would be different. So, let us now look at this muddy children puzzle again from the Kripke structure essentially point of view. So, you can see that we are looking at this example of 3 children here, and the notation is similar. The first letter, the first digit stands for and the second for Bob and the third for Kathy. So, the real situation let us say is this, that Annie and Bob have their foreheads muddy and Kathy does not this thing, but none of them knows that this is really the real situation. So, if you consider Annie, so Annie knows that Bob has 1 and Kathy has 0, or Bob is forehead is muddy and Kathy is not, which is also the case in this, which is connected for Annie, but she does not know whether her forehead is 0 or 1 essentially. Likewise, in the world connected for Bob, you can see that Bob is got 1 in one world and 0 in another world here, and likewise for Kathy, she has got 0 in one world and she has got 1 in the connected world. So, these are the 3 connected worlds. So, none of them really know what is happening essentially. They can see one child or 2 children depending on who they are with muddy foreheads, but they do not know about their own this thing essentially. For all you know, Kathy, from Kathy's point of view, she could also have a muddy forehead, in which case all 3 children would have muddy foreheads essentially. Now, what happens when father comes and makes an announcement that there is at least one child with muddy forehead. So, this state that you can see here 000, everybody removes from their script case structure essentially. So, what you get is a structure which looks like this, that 000 has gone. And now we have states in which at least either one or two or three people have muddy foreheads left essentially. Now he asks the first question essentially. He says that at least one of you, no, he asks, so this is after the state. So after this, he is going to ask the question, do you know whether your forehead is muddy? So you could see that if Bob's forehead was muddy, if that was the real world, if that was the real world, that's not the real world. If Bob's forehead was muddy, if that was the real world, then the only reachable state for Bob would have been only this state. There's only the self loop and nothing else. And Bob would have been able to say yes essentially, because if that was the real world, Bob would have known essentially. Likewise for the other two states which have only one state essentially. Now that is not the real world, that is not the real state. So after the father has asked this question, these three states will vanish from the Kripke structure, and what we will get is this smaller Kripke structure. And you can see that in this Kripke structure either two children have muddy heads or three of them have muddy heads essentially. Now the next time he answers the question, if any of these, oops, okay, I think you can imagine it. If any of these three states were the real state, and one of them is the real state as you can see, they would be able to identify at this stage, because the reachability from there, this is for C, the reachability, the confusion is only for C in this state. Now for both in this state also the confusion is only for A. In this state the confusion is only for B essentially, and this happens to be the real state that we are talking about. So next time you ask the question, both B and A see only self loops here and nothing else, they cannot go anywhere else, and so therefore they know in this state. And so second time he asks the question, only this state is left essentially, and then they have the answer essentially, and then they step forward to say that yes, that's it. So essentially what we went through this argument informally first, and now we are trying to show that how Kripke structures can be manipulated to arrive at this answer essentially. Unfortunately, we do not have time to go too much into detail here. Let us look at this notion called common knowledge, which is a notion which says the following, that we say that a proposition P is common knowledge for a group of agents if first of all everybody knows P, then everybody knows that everybody else knows P, and then everybody knows that everyone knows that everyone knows P, and an infinite amount of nesting or an arbitrary amount of nesting, these formulas will hold true. If that is the case, then we say that it is common knowledge essentially. So obviously you can see that common knowledge happens at times when for example when the father made a public announcement, everybody knows that, and everybody knows that everybody else also knows that essentially. So there is an example which we do not have here today, but you know, if there are these two generals who are planning an attack over something and they are over some distance, so if one of them sends a message to the other general, we will attack in the morning, then is this common knowledge? It is not, because the general one who has sent the message does not know whether general two has received the message or not. So obviously that is why in networks we have protocols to get around things like this. So general 2 sends back an acknowledgement saying that yeah, I received the message, we will attack in the morning, but does general 2 know whether general 1 received his acknowledgement? You can see that there is an arbitrary nesting where there is some degree of uncertainty for one of the two generals at least, and therefore it's never common knowledge. Of course, if one of them had picked up the phone and spoken to the other person, it would have been common knowledge. So common knowledge is when not only everybody knows, but everybody is, you can say, dead sure that everybody else knows essentially. So as we can see, that any public announcement like the father's is instrumental in arriving at common knowledge, even though the definition of common knowledge looks very, very sort of daunting, that you must have arbitrary nesting must be allowed for this knowledge operators essentially. So we have this notion called mutual knowledge, which is a weaker notion than common knowledge. It only requires that a group of people, in a group of people, everybody knows this formula P, then it is mutual knowledge essentially. So in the muddy children's case, if the father whispered to each child something, we don't know what, okay, but let's say that, you know, between us it was the same thing, that the same sentence that he said publicly, he whispers it privately to each child, but the other child, every child doesn't know what he has whispered to the other child. Then it turns out that they are not able to arrive at the answer. So mutual knowledge is not enough. Even though everybody knows that some child is muddy, they are not able to arrive at the answer essentially. So in the muddy children puzzle, so if he whispers in everybody's ear this thing, then for k is equal to 1, it's not a problem, because that particular individual whose forehead is muddy, he'll figure out that his forehead is muddy and he'll come up with the answer. But for k greater than 1, it doesn't work, because even though you know that the other person should have answered yes, you still don't know whether the other person knows whether this statement which the father announced essentially, because the father whispered something into his ear, who knows what he whispered into his ear essentially. So if the father goes and whispers this sentence into every individual ear, it is mutual knowledge because everybody knows this, but it's not common knowledge because we do not know what the father whispered into the other child's ear, and therefore they are not able to come up. So it's not common knowledge, and so they don't know whether the other child knows the original statement or not, and therefore they are not able to complete the reasoning task, which says that if he had known that there is a muddy head, he would have come forward, and so mutual knowledge is not enough in this case essentially. So if P is mutual knowledge, if K is greater than 1, the children will never be able to conclude that their foreheads are muddy. But it has been shown that if up to a nesting of depth k, and you can see that it is intuitively also clear that if to k levels of nesting, you know that I know that he knows that she knows that kind of stuff, up to k levels of nesting it is known, then that is enough to okay. So it can be shown that if there is k levels of nesting in the knowledge representation, then if at most k people have muddy foreheads, then they will still be able to arrive at the answer, because that will be enough for them to figure out that they don't know this much essentially. So you don't really need common knowledge in this situation, you just need sufficient knowledge essentially, which is that up to some k levels you should have those statements essentially. Okay, so I think with this we will end the course, and I hope you all enjoyed it and learned something from this, and we will meet during the exam next time.